Hi students, today we have a very important poem to discuss. It is A Slumber Did My Spirit Steal, which has been composed by William Wordsworth. As you know that this is a fantastic poem, and the poet has poured his philosophy of life and death in this very small poem in 8 lines. We know that this is a kind of elegy, but it lights on so many important things which are related to our spiritual life as well as material life. Before we are going to talk about the innermost meaning of this poem, I think that we should talk prologue to A Slumber Did My Spirit Steal. I am Dr. Naveen Kumar Jha, Associate Professor in English. Talk about the circumstance in which the poem has been composed. Historically speaking, we can say that this poem was written in 1798 and published in 1800. It was published in the edition in Lyrical Ballads, which included Lucy poem, and we find that this is the poem which contains 8 lines, which has been divided into 2 stanzas, and each stanza has 4 lines. We can see that it is a very simple and a small poem. From the lexical point of view as well, we can say that this poem is written for a child, that even a child has no problem so far as lexicon used in this poem is concerned to decipher. I think that poet was of the view that the poet deals with the serious issue, so it should be composed into simple language. Or we can also say that when a poet has to talk about something very serious in his mind, he just needs to be very much clear of the idea first. And once a person is clear in the idea, he is able to cast his idea into very simple language. So we can say that the poet William Wordsworth has been clear as to the meaning of life and death, and so he has kept into very simple poem, A Slumber Did My Spirit Steal. We know that the first stanza is built upon an even sporophic or narcotic movement, in which figurative language conveys the nebulous, unfixed image of a girl. We know that there is an image of a girl named Lucy. In the poem, the poet does not mention her name, or we can say that it is simply the pronoun which has been used for Lucy, but it refers to an unfixed image of a girl. Whosoever was in the mind of the poet is not clear, because The poet has not very clearly taken her name in the poem, and the poet has not made any reference to the girl that he is talking of. But this just unfixed image of a girl named Lucy has been instrumental for the poet to explore the idea of life and idea of death. And we know that it is a metaphysical issue. We can say that it has been discussed in the religious text as well. And religious teacher and philosopher have been equally interested in knowing the concept of life and the concept of death. But they too have not been able to come to as definite a conclusion as William Wordsworth has come here in this poem. So when we can come to the first stanza, we find that it is full with narcotic moment. And in the second stanza also, the poet maintains the quiet even tone of the first. So he serves to undermine the former sense of the eternal by revealing that Lucy has, by the time of composition, died. So coming to the second stanza, by the description of the poem, we come to the conclusion that Lucy is no more. Here also, we find that he has not directly talked about the death of Lucy. We refer to the point, we infer that Lucy is no more by the description, by the very much way that the poet has kept the idea. So we can also say that there are so many images which are made to think about an unfixed image of a girl. Then we are just coming to the death of that unfixed image of a girl. But the main point was just what we can call the response of the poet to the death of unfixed image of a girl named Lucy. So we see that the poet was not thinking that ever Lucy will be dead. He was so mad in love of Lucy that he was not sure that Lucy too is going to die. But this idea, or rather mistaken idea, is just in slumber that he has fallen. It was all slumber due to his love. He was just in love of Lucy, so he was in slumber of the reality too. He was not knowing the reality that all the objects, including animate or inanimate, are to decompose one day. Nothing has a permanent existence in this world, no matter how much love we have for that thing. It is our personal imposition about the object or about the person that we want to see her all the time. We want to see her beyond death, that death should not reach her. But we know that it is as certain as a day. We simply cannot avoid death to come, even to the loveliest thing that we have. So this idea has been very much known by the poet, coming to the second stanza. So Coming to the second stanza, we have the speaker's or narrator's response to her death. And he does not have any sort of bitterness or impertinence. Instead, there is a consolation on the part of the speaker that she is now beyond life's trials. So generally we find that we lament for the person, the lovely thing that we are in love. We always try to say that it should not happen. The person, the thing whom we like most should not die. It is what our conception is. But when a person dies, whom we love most, we lament for the loss of the person, for the loss of the emotional relation that we have developed. But here you find that poet's spirit is awakened with the death of Lucy. And so he has realized through her death that nothing is just going to be off from us permanently. It is rather a kind of transition from one life to another life. Hence we find that he is not lamenting the death, or we do not find any sort of bitterness or impertinence anywhere in the poem when the poet realizes that Lucy is dead. So we should know that it is simply a kind of just making or interpreting the life and death in terms of natural phenomena. We find that during the autumn of 1798, Wordsworth traveled to Germany with his sister Dorothy and T.S. Coleridge. And from October 1798, Wordsworth worked on the first drafts of his lyrical poems, Lucy poems rather, which included strange fits of passion, have I known, she dwelt among the untrodden ways and slumbered my spirit still. And we find that in December 1798, Wordsworth sent copies of Strange Fits and She Dwelt to Coleridge. Eventually, Slumber Did My Spirit Still was published in 1800 in edition of Lyrical Ballads. And actually, it was such a revolutionary poem that has actually defined death in a very philosophical manner. Philosophical as well as it is simple to understand. Generally, we find that when we are talking about some sort of philosophy, we become grave and serious, that it is rather a serious matter talked, and we need certain kind of seriousness to understand. But when the poet is simply describing all these kind of things, he is serious, but he tries to make his reader as much normal as he could. Into normal state of mind, he thinks that this kind of theme is to be better dealt with, and the person, the reader, can understand it well as well. So how easy it is to describe death as a transition from the physical life to the natural life. When we are alive, we remain a physical existence. But when we are dead, we become the part of nature. So death is just a natural phenomenon. We cannot say that death is something unnatural, or death must be taken very seriously, or it is the matter for which we should weep. I do not find that there is any line or any word which makes us weep. No, there is no situation of lamentation to the extent that we start weeping. We rather are relieved when you know that Lucy has become the part of the nature, and now she will always be the part of the nature. And it is very clear that our life is also a part of nature, and so is our death. When we are alive, we should be in association with nature, because our life is just a link of nature. And because we are just knowingly or unknowingly, intentionally or intentionally avoiding this very philosophy that we are the link of nature, it is why we create lots of problems in our life. But when it is a matter of death, because we do not have any control over death, so it is very smoothly going from just material life to natural life. We cannot control this to happen because it is beyond our control. And we can see that poet also does not want Lucy die, but Lucy dies. But when Lucy dies, how should he respond to her death? Should he start crying over death of Lucy? Is it the way that we should respond when we lose someone or we lose our nearest and dearest? It is not the true way that we should just express our feeling to the diseased one. When we consider the thing as a natural process, we are relieved. When we are in life, we are in motion. When we are in death, we still are in motion. We are in motion with natural objects. Our body becomes the part of the nature. And so with nature, we are moving now. And when we are moving with nature, we always are integrated with nature. And finally, we can say that we always remain till nature remains. We become an integral part of nature, and nature will always remain. So death makes us immortal as a matter of fact. Death makes our life continue to immortality, because nature is a permanent existence. The movement of earth is the permanent phenomenon, and with the movement of the earth, Lucy is also moving. So till the earth moves, Lucy will be moving, and so we cannot say it death. Generally, we find that by death we mean something over, something finished. We find that no, there is no further existence after death. We find that life is over with death. But William Wordsworth does not think that we should talk in terms of completion of our life after death. And if we are thinking that we are living with nature, we should understand that we will always be essentially integrated with nature. And when we are integrated with nature, we find that we will always be alive with nature. Yes, so it is a kind of transformation that from the physical life that we have been enjoying, now we are enjoying our status as a natural phenomenon. So we find that it is just a greater dimension. Death makes our life just something greater than we have been living. Now, so far, just we are linked with nature, and after death, we are the integral part of nature. When we are alive, we try to just adjust ourselves to the natural order. It is why we are going to link ourselves with nature for our smooth running, for our what you can call cozy life. But once we are dead, we are permanently associated with death. And with death, we become the nature itself. Now, we are nature. Death makes us a natural object. And when we become nature, now we have been more influential. So in life, we have been not as much influential as we have after death. So we are going to have a very powerful impact on the life of the living people after death, because that is very much an instrumental, just a force to shape the just a life of the people or the living being on the earth. So when we are moving with earth, we can say on that moment of which we are the part, everything depends. The life of the people depends. So William Wordsworth is very philosophically talking about death and giving it a new dimension, that nature lives every time. Nature is not going just simply off, and it is more powerful. It is embodied in terms of rocks and trees, and so we are now very much integrated with rocks and trees and other natural objects, and we can say that here we become much more influential force to make the world move on. It is with this what you can call just a prologue to A Slumber Did My Spirit Sleep. We stop today, and next time we'll be talking about very much the internal and external ideas that the poet has in this poem. Thank you very much.